he is one of our favourite authors and a regular here on Studio 10. Tom Keneally's got a brand new book out about a fascinating chapter in our history. Let's bring him out. Make him welcome, everyone.
Hello, everyone. Hello. Hello, Jessica.
Nice to see you. Oh, that cackle little
How did
exactly
the wedding go? Has it lasted?
Yes, so far so good.
She's still got her.
Why? Why do you want to know, Tom? Look, before we get into it, Tom, I just want to talk to you very quickly. You and Gough Whitlam were close friends.
Well, yes, I suppose he had many close friends, but we were close whenever we saw each other. That's why we're staying with him, my wife, my beautiful wife in the corner there. Aww. Staying with him in Paris, in and
he actually looks a bit suspicious of you, Tom. What have you just done?
He does. I think I stole the peanuts. who stole the bloody peanuts? but he was practicing his French at that stage, and he used to say he found it hard to get a bank card to work. He said to my daughter, "Où est mon banque?" And he never referred to Patrick White as Patrick White, but Patrice Blanc.
Yeah, so sad to see him pass yesterday, but he's certainly being remembered as a giant among men. Now, let's talk about
your book.
What a title. It's enormous.
And it only covers the end of World War One to Vietnam, and I hope to finish Volume 4 up to the present before I fall off the perch.
But so volume
it's a biography of Australia, sort of, isn't it?
From the point of view of obscure people, for example, often from the point of view of obscure people, there's a lot of scandal in it. But, for example, my wife has a brother who flew 90 missions over Europe. We just took that for granted because it was what blokes did. But I got hold of his log, and through reading his log and comparing it with the official record of those 90 missions, which included D-Day, you can put together a picture of what these young men thought they were doing and what was actually happening on the ground. And that's basically the method I use. I told the story of White Australia from the point of view of Japanese brides, Japanese wives of Australian occupation troops, because they couldn't bring them home because of White Australia.
It's incredible how far. Speaking of Whitlam, it's interesting. Whitlam was actually a navigator in the Air Force, and he always kept a log, even long after he'd left when he was Prime Minister in his private life. Always kept a log of everywhere he travelled because he was so used to so carefully documenting every single trip he made, because it used to be of enormous military importance.
He flew a lot of missions. And typical of him, on his leave in 1944, when other blokes went and got tanked, he went to a summer school on post-war reconstruction in Canberra. And that's typical of Gough. But what I liked about him best was the fact that any politician, right or left, who had that happen to him, that terrible trauma, the temptation to just go away and die and hide or go to Italy, which he loved, and stay there and no longer be a citizen must have been great. And yet he and Margaret remained citizens throughout. They attended everything, envelope opening, except for the obvious Australian things like cricket tests and rugby league tests and so on. They were never at them.
Never the junkets, the opera, always the community.
The opera, political events. And I remember one day he was... he went to the Eureka anniversary and his knees were beginning to give out, and they said, "We're going to move you up onto the plinth in your chair." And he said, "Oh, then I'll be a monument upon a monument."
You've got such a wonderful way with words and storytelling, and we're so excited about your new book, Thomas Keneally. There we go. Let's have a look at that. Everyone in our studio audience today is getting a copy of Tom's new book. Australians, flappers to Vietnam. It's a wonderful story. Check it out. We're going to take a break. Thank you very much for joining us, Thomas. Always
a pleasure. Thank you.